Mentorship. This is a topic that's really near and dear to my heart. When people learn what I do and who I do it for, they think, oh, you must have had to go to some really specialized, fancy training. You know, what did you go for school for? And while I went to university and gained a lot of fancy words and had a really good time, everything that I've learned that I do on a daily basis was learned through mentorship. I really see today in the world and the way that we're headed, there seems to be less and less connection between generations for that mentorship to happen. And in this, we really start to lose this intergenerational knowledge of place, of practice, of self and where we come from. And it's really sad in a way. And I think it's important in this day and age that we find times to find ways to bridge this gap between generations that's really starting to form. You know, in days gone by, you lived near your family, you spent a lot of time with the different generations and you learned from them. And as we understand with shifting baseline syndrome, what we think of as normal tends to change over time. And it's actually just an average of the past handful of years. And certainly we, with our own personal experience, can only go back through our own lifetime. But through these elders, we can start to understand how things have changed over a longer period of time. And if you make space and learn these stories, they're full of so much wealth of place, of people, of understanding of what it used to be like and what it could be like again. And if you listen to the elders in communities, it's often stories of waterways going dry and waters becoming polluted and low quality and the climate becoming less stable and rains not being as consistent and temperatures and patterns falling out of whack. This really all comes from our disturbance of the water landscape around us, of this connection between water and landscape. And so by making space and really creating this bridge between generations, we can better understand what our landscapes used to be like and what a more healthy state is. We're losing so rapidly the understanding of the places where we live. If you think just a handful of years ago, fire season where there's just smoke in the air for a handful of months in the summer wasn't a typical occurrence. And now really quickly, we're seeing that fire season window expand wider and wider with fires happening when they never have historically and in places where they never have historically. And we're really quickly starting to just accept this as the new normal. So I think it's important to bridge this generational gap to understand. In many cases, you hear stories of people having plenty from the landscape, having landscapes that produced food immediately around them, having the resources that they needed to really thrive in healthy landscapes and environments where they made their homes. And so for myself, I've benefited from all sorts of mentors. Most importantly, you could say was Sepp Holzer, who at a time when I was at a ripe age, just rewired my brain and the way to look at landscape and how to interact with it. And I have so much appreciation and gratitude for that. And this is something I could have never learned in any university. I could have gone to all of the highest institutions and not learned this essential skill to do what I now do. And this is the way it's been for thousands of years. Blacksmiths had apprentices that learned the trade that then became themselves blacksmiths. And so I think it's really important for us to not lose these skills. You see people of my generation and younger, a lot of them don't know how to use a wrench or swing a hammer. And these are skills that nearly everyone used to have a handful of years ago. You go back to my grandma's generation, she produced everything that they needed on a farm. And you know, it wasn't always easy, but they had enough to live and they had a high quality of food and a high quality of life. And in just two generations, that knowledge was lost. And so it's really important that we start to bridge these gaps, that we learn the traditional ecological knowledge of place that's all around us. You look at other examples of this, like the work of Rajendra Singh in India, in Rajasthan, where it was really indigenous practices that they just started applying again that revived these landscapes, that brought water back to wells, and these exist for every biome on the planet. Are you ready to rejuvenate landscapes, restore ecosystems, and even revive rivers? To move beyond the theory and start practicing ecosystem regeneration? To succeed, you'll need skills, support, and confidence. It's why I created the Water Stories Core Course, to empower you to heal landscapes and revive waterways with your own hands and heart. I've spent the past decade implementing projects all around the world, not theoretical designs, but real results on land. I put all of the lessons I've learned from working with legends like Sepp Holzer and Rajendra Singh into this course. The Water Stories Core Course gives you everything you need to actualize projects on the ground and in your community. For each module, actions guide you through the experiences you'll need to become competent and then confident reading and regenerating land. From the technical aspects of earthworks and ecosystem establishment, to the personal development you'll need to be effective, to providing a business roadmap for success, this course offers a transformational experience that reshapes your relationship with water, land, and life. As hopeful as I was when we began, even I've been surprised how quickly it's delivered results for our students. No matter where you live and no matter your background, you can help heal the earth with water cycle restoration. Check the link below for upcoming courses, and I'll see you in class. And so there were a lot of times that Sepp, you know, pushed me, I wouldn't say to the edge, but, you know, pushed me in a way that really stressed me, that really caused me distress and emotional toil. But that helped me achieve so much more as a result. And so it didn't always feel great at the time, but it feels really great now with the outcomes it's achieved. And then he's really been there for me at times when I needed support as well. You know, recommending me for some big projects. I didn't handle some of the paperwork for visas quickly as I should have, and it caused these issues and, you know, a pretty uncomfortable situation where they sent Sepp notice saying, you know, this is not the guy, he's not organized. But Sepp was immediately there for me. And, you know, they asked him to send someone else, and he said, you work with Zach or you work with no one. And for myself, I didn't really want to go because, you know, before I'd even met these people, they're sending this nasty email to my very important mentor about me. But I'm so glad he pushed me into that he made me do that, because it ended up being a great time, a great relationship with great people doing great projects. And, you know, it was really important. And he said, if we let these human things always get in our way, we're never going to achieve what we need to for the planet. And so in these moments where I was really pushed towards the edge, I had to remember that, you know, I'm not doing this for the approval of anyone or for anything other than all of our non-human brothers and sisters on this planet. That is, for me, my driving motivation. You know, all these beautiful creatures, plants, and species all around the world, they're not complicit in the disturbance of the water cycle, but they're experiencing the effects and the results even more harshly than us ourselves. And so whenever I get pushed in a way that it really stresses me, I remember that core of why I'm doing this, who I'm doing this for, and I immediately have just this flush of energy through my body where I'm able to overcome any challenge that's in the way. And, you know, before this apprenticeship, before having these mentors, that wasn't the person who I was. And it's been through mentorship with a whole host of different people and always being open to learn and gain and always putting myself out there. You know, a lot of times these mentors are not going to be people in your typical circles. You're going to have to go to places where you don't feel comfortable. You're going to have conversations where you don't feel comfortable. You're going to have to stretch and learn and grow to then take on and model the behaviors that really suit you. And so this is a really great way to learn. If you're someone who's been trying to do this kind of work for years and just not been able to put it all together, I think mentorship is one of the key ingredients that people often miss. And so find a mentor in your area. Mentorship is something that we offer to the best of our abilities through the course. There's going to be a whole variety of people all around you that have gained real skills, knowledge, and experience. It's very pertinent to that place, that have lived experience on that landscape and can help you better understand that landscape. And so I hope this really pushes you to go into those uncomfortable situations. Find those new people to bridge connections with. Put yourself out there, offer something first, make yourself useful to them, and I think you'll really be amazed at where it leads you.